It's my great pleasure to introduce Professor Sergei Trail from Brown University, who will speak on matrix Clark measures, singular spectrum, and matrix Cartier-Dori angular derivatives.
Please. Thank you very much for the invitation. And so I'll be talking about kind of very classical subject, but with a modern twist that kind of non-commutative twist that it's everything is matrix weighted. So first of all, let me introduce the main object. And first of all, matrix valued measures. What is matrix valued measure? Of course, we can say that it is just matrix measures on the unit circle, we live on the unit circle, is just a countably additive function on Borel sigma algebra with values in positive semi-definite matrices. So that is, but kind of in matrix case, we can, of course, one can define operator valued measure, but it's more complicated. But in matrix valued case, we can see it is the matrix of measures, where on the diagonal, we have honest to God positive measures, and off the diagonal, we have signed or complex valued measures, depending on which universe we live, so generally complex valued measures. And we want to integrate with respect to measure, we want to like compute something like L2 norms with respect to this measure. And what is that? In matrix case, unlike the operator valued case, everything is very simple. Namely, we can define scalar measure by defining just trace, just summing up the diagonal entries. It will be matrix. And we can see that all other measures of diagonal are absolutely continuous with respect to this trace. For example, from positive semi-definite, because, and therefore we can write that our measure M is absolutely continuous with respect to the measure mu. So measure mu can be singular, but weight is just a function. And so finding the weight, finding the L2 norm of a function f, it is just integrating this expression matrix multiplied by vector inner product with vector. And that is something very simple, again, unlike the operator case. I should say also that kind of it's all will be easier if matrix has values in trace class operators, for example. Now, what is Clark measure? So let we have theta will be matrix valued analytic function in the unit disk. And it is a strictly contractive analytic matrix valued function. So we consider that, for example, theta at zero, a norm has norm less than one, and norm is a standard operator norm of the matrix, so largest singular value. And this, of course, implies that in the unit disk, a norm can be, in the unit disk, norm also will be one. But on the boundary, norm can be one, and in the boundary, we can have boundary values can be, for example, unitary operators everywhere or almost everywhere. And usually it is one can think of theta as characteristic function of a contraction. Now, for a unitary matrix, we can consider. So if we take constant unitary matrix alpha, and we consider H alpha being such linear fractional transform of theta. And we can take, we can see that H alpha, it's, if we consider, for example, scalar transform, this, this linear fractional transformation map the unit disk into the right half plane. So the real part of H alpha in the scalar case is non-negative. And that is the same in the case of matrix valued functions. And here I kind of should emphasize that for matrix A, real part of A, it is just one half of A plus, it's written here. Yeah, it's just one half of A plus A star. Unlike what sometimes people just take real parts of matrix entries. Now, we all know that if we have non-negative harmonic function in the unit disk, inside the unit disk, then it's a Poisson extension of some measure, some non-negative measure on the boundary. That is a classical result, and this classical result, there is a classical generalization to the case of matrix valued functions or even a greater valued function. So there exists unique matrix measure, which I call M alpha. It's non-negative measure, such that a real part of alpha is the Poisson extension. Or we can write it in this way. So how we restore function by its real part. We just take this Cauchy type integral, sometimes Cauchy Schwarz integral, and we just like add imaginary part because we don't have imaginary part. So that is what is classical Clark measure. And kind of originally they were introduced with connection with Dobranc-Ravniak vector valued spaces. But I like to think about this matrix Clark measures as matrix spectral measures. And what is a spectral matrix valued spectral measure? Now, suppose we have unitary operator in Hilbert space, and suppose we have some invertible operator, say from finite dimensional space to the H, so left invertible, and usually we consider that this B is isometry. And then we introduce matrix spectral measure as the measure such that its Cauchy transform correspond to this resolved expression. Okay, for those who kind of prefer this abstract spectral theorem with abstract spectral measure, which is projection valued measure, we can say that our measure M of any Borel set E is B star E of E B, where E is operator valued, projection valued spectral measure, like in the spectral theorem. So it is the same. And if B is rank one operator, it's usual scalar spectral measure of the operator. And if range of B is star cyclic, means that star cyclic means that span of un range B over all exponent, over all integer exponent, that the closed span is the whole space H, that means then U is unitary equivalent to multiplication by Z and in L2, in weighted L2 T with matrix valued weight M, and we introduce the norm. So it's, in fact, form of spectral theorem that I prefer, that to abstract spectral theorem, because, for example, all we know that for cyclic operator is just unitary operator is just unitarily equivalent to multiplication operator in L2 mu in usual scalar measure. And it is just generalization of usual scalar measure. And in fact, it was introduced considered in early day of spectral theory, and it can be used to prove Cator-Rosenblum theorem, and in fact, Kuroda and Debranche presented proof of that. And kind of one remark that if B is isometry, then M is probability measure, so measure of the whole circle is identity operator. And so another point of view of this, it is a contractive perturbation. So suppose we have two subspaces of the Hilbert space. And so, suppose we fix an isometry B, that range is one of the subspaces. And let us find family of rank of all finite rank perturbation by operator K that ranges inside this subspace. It can be parameterized like that. And this can be checked usually just by doing some algebra, or I prefer just to consider first the case when U is identity operator and then just multiply everything by U, and it is very. And I should say that if gamma is unitary matrix, then U gamma is unitary as well. And we use lambda instead of cas. And the Clark family in this case is this matrix spectral measure of these operators U lambda, so lambda instead of gamma. Now, if gamma is a contractive operator, if gamma norm is a contractive, then we can assume that then U gamma is also contractive operators, and we use T gamma in this case. And let us assume that gamma is a strict contraction. And for finite dimension, it means that norm of gamma strictly less than one for finite dimension. And then if ranges start cyclic and the gamma strict contraction, then U gamma is what is called completely non-unitary contraction, meaning that there is no like orthogonal unitary part sticking out. So, and completely non-unitary contractions, CNU, which I use for abbreviation, it's completely defined by what is called characteristic function. And what is characteristic function? It is sum, in this case of finite defects, it is sum matrix valued bounded analytic function, which is contractive. So at each point, it is a contraction. And there is a formula that can be found in any kind of classical textbook, in Nat Foisch textbook, for example, on what is called functional model. So suppose we have two defect, so we define those two defect operators, defect of the T and the defect of T star, and the defect spaces, which is just closures of the ranges. And suppose we have two abstract spaces of the corresponding dimension, and suppose we have unitary operators that identify those defect spaces with abstract spaces of dimension, and then characteristic function is defined like that. Now, this is formula essentially formula from the Knight Foyer's book, harmonic analysis of operators, but there is a little bit new trick which kind of introduced by Nikolsky, because in Knight Foyer's book, characteristic function considered acting from one defect space to another, and very often we kind of consider situation when we're acting not within these abstract defect spaces, but from some spaces of appropriate dimension, and so we need this identifying operators. Again, that is standard formula. And and we consider in our specific case, I don't want you to kind of memorize, pay much attention, but everything can be computed. So if gamma is strict contraction, then defect operators can be, it is just range of B, defect operator of, it is range of U star B, so one of the defect operators and characteristic function, there is a simple formula. And essential part here is this C1M of Z, where C1 is non-standard Cauchy transform, so it is just this integral. And C1 of M, so we have to integrate with respect to matrix valued measure M, not with scalar measure mu. And that is like one of the Cauchy transform. And kind of I emphasize that theta gamma of zero in this case, it is just minus gamma because this part just disappears. So this is formula for, and kind of, let me say, digression, how one can compute this formula. I use this trick kind of a lot, and I did not know that this has a name. It's called Woodbury inversion formula. And this Woodbury inversion formula, that if we have kind of two operators BC acting like that, then inverse of this operator is identity NH plus the inverse of B star C. And kind of advantage of this formula is that B star C acts in E. And if E is like finite dimensional, we just have to invert matrices, not operators. And if it's E is one dimensional, we just have to take inverse of a number. So it is very easy. And to get the formula to, we just decompose this using geometric series, and then take the first term and take C out on the left, B star out on the right, and the rest geometric formula give us this expression. But kind of formal proof, this can be done kind of rigorously for matrix valued case by introducing small analytic parameter lambda and kind of using analytic continuation, but the easiest formal proof after we know the formula is just by checking by left and right multiplying. And in rank one, it also has a name, formula that people and perturbation theory use a lot. And I kind of explained that the inverse of this is multiplication by this operator, and therefore when Cauchy integrals appear. Now, so how this related to them? To the Clark mirrors that we introduced in before. Let me introduce three Cauchy transforms. The standard Cauchy transforms here is the C1 mu, and C2 mu, or sometimes it's called Schwarz integral, that is used to restore function from its real part. and they all have like very simple relations between them. And when gamma is zero, so gamma, remember what is that? It's gamma is this gamma, so when this gamma is zero in perturbation, then everything simplifies a lot, and we get that theta with gamma equal given by this C2, or Cauchy transform is given by that. And that is exactly kind of the definition of Clark measure with alpha equal one. So for me, at least for gamma, for me, Clark measures are spectral measures of some unitary operators. And when gamma not zero, relation between gamma and alpha more complicated, and namely the classic, so that M is classical spectral measure, and this classical Clark measure, and M Tweedle is the Clark measure obtained from the point of view of unitary perturbation, and one from the other is obtained by just rescaling. Classical ones is this, so it's, and this is one from the perturbation theory. And so everything kind of can be rescaled. And when you think from the point of view of perturbation theory, your all Clark measures are probability measure, so the total measure is identity operator, and for classical Clark measures, the probability measures only in specific case when theta of zero is zero. Now, why this name Clark? So the scalar situation started from the work of Douglas Clark, and what he did, he considered case when theta is inner function, one can associate so-called model operator in just restriction of, say, backward shift on this subspace, it is operators with defect subspaces equal by one. So there is family of rank one perturbations that make it this operator unitary. And he studied all these rank operations in their spectral measures, and he got those spectral measures, but only for inner function. And then in a series of work with Connie Liao, we did kind of the general case. We consider the general case when theta is general contractive function. In this case, model is simplified. And then we consider when theta is a general contractive matrix valued function. But we went from unitary operators to contractions. It is possible to go from contractive operator from model to unitary operators, but we kind of didn't do the algebra. Now let us investigate the property of the classical Clark measures. So how can we construct how can we find absolutely continuous part of these Clark measures, and singular parts? And the absolutely continuous part, it's very easy. So for this, if we given this function theta, contractive function theta, we consider on the boundary this defect function. And essentially, defect function is just this the absolutely continuous part is just this transformation of this defect function. And it's not hard to see that those term is invertible almost everywhere on the circle, and spectral multiplicity of the multiplicity of IC part is rank of this defect operators almost everywhere. Now I should emphasize that why I'm interested, most interesting cases are kind of cases of kind of singular. So remember our measure M can be represented as W d mu. And in most interesting case, this weight W does not have full rank almost everywhere. And classical examples, if we consider, for example, a cyclic operator, just multiplication by Z in some scalar L2 mu, but we take its rank D perturbation, we have matrix valued measures, and but density will have rank one almost everywhere. And that is kind of typical situation, that is interesting situation, and that is what kind of one we should have in mind. Now, let us see what can we say about singular particles. Okay, first of all, let us consider this H alpha, and let everything be scalar. So if everything is scalar, so we have harmonic function, which is which is just Poisson extension of some scalar measures. Okay, where the singular part of this measure lives? And that is a classical result. We have to consider points on the circle where non-tangential boundary values of these harmonic functions, of this harmonic function are infinity, and there the singular part of the measure lives, meaning that on the complement of this set, there is no singular part. And more on, we can say that in fact, singular measure lives in the set, in the scalar case, where the denominator is zero. So when boundary value of theta of z are equal alpha. But again, in the situation of matrix valued function, it is all kind of new phenomena arise. So we have different directions and I should say kind of new phenomena of directionality appears. And I should have a proposition that for every E in the range of W alpha, the non-tangential limit of this theta star of ZE exists mu s almost everywhere and exists and equal to this. And now we consider the set S alpha at the point of Xi. It is just a collection of the directions such that this limit exists and equals that. And it is directional support of M alpha. And this directional support is, of course, trivial almost everywhere with respect to Lebesgue measure. So what we can say is that range W alpha so lives in this directional support almost everywhere. And in particular, we can say that directional support of with alpha equal one and directional support with alpha up to this factor are orthogonal for all xi in orthogonal for all xi at. So we can say that in rank one perturbation, there is classical Aronshine-Donahue theorem that says that for singular, that for rank one perturbation, singular spectra, singular spectral measures are mutually absolutely singular. And here they mutually absolutely singular if we kind of, in the definition, take into account, directionality. So that is. And how we prove this proposition? Okay, the first part is we have this formula for that defined our M, and we can rewrite it after some algebra in this situation, and then we multiply, right, multiply both sides by this, and we get this identity. And the limit of Cauchy transform of a singular measure, of Cauchy transform of a measure, is infinity almost everywhere with respect to its singular part, which is kind of classical stuff. And now I use what is called Poltoratsky theorem. And Poltoratsky theorem says that if we have Cauchy transform of f mu, and we divide it by Cauchy transform of mu, and we take non-tangential limit as z approaches to point xi on the boundary, then we got f of xi mu s almost everywhere with respect to the singular part. So with respect to singular part, we kind of can just cross out Cauchy and mu and get f as a limit. So it's a great theorem. And if you apply this kind of entry-wise, we will get that non-tangential limit is this. And if we can write formally this identity and take an adjoint, we get that. Of course, there is a kind of little problem because who says that non-tangential limit of this theta of z exists, but okay. So we have to do kind of a little bit careful analysis of limit, but it can be done. So that is kind of singular, what can be said about singular part. Now let's talk about the Carathéodory angular derivative. So again, that is classical topic. Suppose we have scalar contractive function in scalar bounded analytic function. H infinity is the set of bounded analytic function. And we say that theta has a Carathéodory angular derivative at point xi. First of all, the non-tangential limit exists at this point and equals some point alpha of absolute value one. And the second, this non-tangential limit exists. And this limit is called Carathéodory angular derivative. And it's in fact like, indeed like consider the classical definition of the derivative because alpha is like a theta of xi. We can say that alpha is like theta of xi. So it is just like the derivative, but we take only a non-tangential limit, so when z approaches xi inside of some angle. And it is kind of, again, classical fact that this non-tangential angular derivative is just non-tangential limit of derivatives. So it is just kind of equivalent to the existence of theta star. And the scalar case. So every measure can be decomposed, absolutely continuous part and singular part with respect to Lebesgue measure. And singular part is decomposed into atomic part, so purely atomic, which is just a sum of delta measures with some coefficient plus singular continuous part. And purely atomic part, so it lives on the set where of mu alpha, live on the set where boundary values of theta of z equal alpha and a Cassiodori angular derivative exists. And moreover, we can say what is mu alpha of xi. Very often people just write that mu alpha at the point xi is just one divided by absolute value of the angular derivative of point xi. Now let us discuss what happens in the matrix case. And in the matrix case, we have that M alpha at the point xi coincide with this non-tangential limit. And non-tangential limit, it's like the definition of Cassiodori angular derivatives only flipped. And the proof is kind of pretty simple. So we have this equality that can be obtained easily by a simple algebraic manipulation from the definition of Clark measure. We multiply both sides by this and take a limit. And after multiplying, and because this is a constant, it will disappear. And here we will get integral of this type. And so we will get mu alpha of xi plus integral over this. And this graph just disappears by. So in the matrix case. Now let me kind of go back and look at this equation. And suppose we know that this is invertible. If this is invertible, we can just take inverse of this equation, consider limit, and we will get that Cassiodori angular derivative exists in kind of classical sense. And everything is fine. But what to do in the general case? And I said that my most interesting case that I'm interested in is when everything is degenerate. So this quantity does not have full rank, is not invertible. And I will be considering, for simplicity of notation, we'll consider on the case alpha equal I identity matrix, and then everything kind of be obtained from Hebel by simple changing theta by theta alpha star. And we need to introduce a kind of new definition. We have to introduce definition of Caratteodori derivative on a subspace. And the definition is exactly the same. So first of all, for all vectors in this subspace, non-tangential limit is E. And the second, the derivative, this limit of derivatives exist. And we have to pre and post multiply everything by projection, orthogonal projection on tree. And equivalent definition, kind of simple, that it happens if and only if when this limit exists. And again, that is like limit in the classical definition of Caratteodori angular derivative. And but with those projections PE. And the question is how, is there always exist maximal subspace on which angular derivative exists? And if you just try to prove it immediately, you will see that it is not kind of completely trivial. And we can say that theta satisfy this Caratteodori condition on the point if this lim-inf is finite. And collection of all Caratteodori codirection with such vectors are called Caratteodori codirection is a kind of is a subspace. So it is indeed subspace, and that is kind of simple use of polarization theorem. And that is. And recall that we give the directional support of singular measure, which was that. And if I defined E alpha part of S alpha, where such E satisfies the Caratteodori condition, then a theorem that E alpha, here I assume that point xi is fixed, so that is E alpha of xi. And basically, Caratteodori angular derivative is exists on this E alpha. And the proof is kind of convoluted, but I will not present it here, but reduce a lot. What I should say is that we have that in Caratteodori angular derivative on a subspace E is this quantity. And we ask ourselves, okay, is it possible to get rid of one of the projections? Again, we cannot get rid of both of the projections. That is kind of simple diagonal examples. We take diagonal function, we take on one diagonal function that has Caratteodori angular derivative at this point, and on the other one that does not. And we can see that at least one projection is needed. And the answer is that, in fact, we need both projections, and that is a simple counterexample just by two matrices. And that is kind of how the counterexample look, and counterexample is in the right half plane. By conformal substitution, we can move it to the unit disk. So we consider this function. It has a non-negative real part, and then we consider function theta, which is just a linear fraction transformation of H. It's a contractive function, and if we kind of do some algebra, we can, this function will give us a counterexample in the right half plane. So that is now what is the Carathéodory angular derivative, and here again, kind of simple generalization of classical result, that if you consider Carathéodory angular derivative at point psi, and let me recall that everything here when alpha equal I, so I don't put index alpha here, then the Carathéodory angular derivative up to this psi, it is just a Murpin-Rose inverse. Mass is just the Murpin-Rose inverse of the Carathéodory angular derivative. Or direction. So that is. Now I kind of want to go back to the question. Kind of to the very beginning, and let me move quickly to the very beginning. And so, why in the definition of this H alpha we put alpha on the right, alpha star on the right, and not on the left? Kind of formally everything will be still. And for me, if you kind of work with perturbation, if you look at Clark measures, at perturbative measures, then that is where you should put alpha. But on the other hand, if you look at the branch Ravniak spaces, then you can also see why it is so. Namely, that what is the branch Ravniak space? So for analytic function theta, we can define Toeplitz operator, which is in this case, it's just multiplication. And the branch Ravniak space is just a range of this operator. So it is the subspace of H2 and endowed with the range norm. So the norm in the range is in fact the norm in the domain. So the norm in the range is the norm in the domain. And if you consider this function, it is matrix reproducing kernel for H theta. And that means that if you want to take F at omega, it is just some vector in CD, and take it projection onto vector E, it is the same as taking product of F and this K W theta, this function multiplied by vector E in the debranch space. It is kind of standard result. And theta star we can see that theta star is here, and that is why alpha star is there in the definition of the Clark measures. And so we obtained kind of the following equivalence of the classical result for matrix measure. And it essentially says that, so classical result of about Carathéodory angular derivative, about Clark theory, says that if we consider this reproducing kernels, then so classical result of on the theory says that if you consider reproducing kernel K of ZW and you allow W go to Xi non-tangentially and F prime of Xi exists, then this stuff converges. The stuff converges to some reproducing kernel K of the Xi and converges in all possible senses. And kind of we get the same result for matrix valued functions, but in the case when in this case, we have only convergence on the derivative. And here kind of precise statements. Okay, let me stop here and thank you very much for the attention.
Thank you. we have time for questions, comments. So if you have a question, then please just go ahead and ask a question. I guess you answered all the questions in your talk already. So So if there aren't any questions, then let's thank our speaker again. Thank you. Yeah.